that God is a redeeming God, and that our God loves us so much. I believe right now that God's word for right now is redeeming right now, that he is the God of hope when it all seems lost. He is a God of hope when it seems like everything else is gone. He is a God of hope when anything bad happens. So let's just sing that out to him just one more time. And if you need hope in your life, that now is the season for redemption. We set our hope on you. We set our hope on your love. We set our hope on the one who is the everlasting God. You are the everlasting God. You are the everlasting God. We set our hope on you. We set our hope on your love. We set our is not like you. I worship you, O Prince of Peace. And that is what I long to do. I give you praise, for you are my righteousness. Sing, I worship.
Your hands and worship the Redeemer, for he is in this very room to touch you, to heal you. The magnificent splendor of the Most High God is here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We worship you. You are the living God. You are the Christ. Glory, glory, glory. That's right. We give you praise. Touch you if you let him. Oh, just let the Holy Spirit touch you. Let his presence wash over you. The living God is here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Master.
There is none.
Heaven singing with us. Thank you, Jesus. Jada, for the Spirit of the living God would say unto you this night, I'm going deep within your body. And I'm removing some obstructions that have caused you pain and torment. For this is your day of miracles. This is your day of healing. For this is your time that you have waited for. Not only physical time, but in that mental realm, God is doing a work in you right now. So let him do it. The power of God is right there on you. Let him fill you up. Thank you, Jesus. More, Lord. More.
There is nothing like you. So sing, I worship. I worship you, Almighty God. There is nothing.
This whole room. Just take that. Take healing right now. Healing is here. Healing is here. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit. We thank you. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Marcia, lift your hands high for the things that you were going to give up and the things that you said, oh God, why? Spirit of God is coming afresh upon you this night. Revival is hitting your heart. The revival that you have cried for and you have hungered for. The revival is coming down from the very Spirit of God. Enemy that has come against you to move you away and to take you to that place that you don't want to go is being lifted. And there's another dose from heaven right now coming down upon you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Saturator in your glory. Saturator in your glory. There's the glory that you really haven't felt good in over 10 years, not like you want it. There it is, right there. Can you lay your hands on her head? There, there's the glory. More. There's the more. There's the more. Oh, Father, we worship you. We worship you, the living God. Yes. There's the very sound of heaven. It's coming here. Just hear, oh, my wife is so radical. I wish I could be like her. I wish I had that radical spirit like her. Oh, if I could just get there. I want to go to that place, but how do I get there, Lord? Yes. The Father says he loves you just like you are. The Father says you don't have to do anything different. That the Father loves you, and he's seen your heart. He's seen your worship. Oh, the radical is good, but you're radical in your heart. And your heart of love is bursting forth, not only for him, but your family. And how the Holy Spirit loves you. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Father, we worship you. We worship you. Holy God, holy God, holy God. Lisa, come here. Lisa, come here. Oh, Shorabas, Shorabas. I hear the Master say unto you this night that I have stepped you into a new season. And in this time, it's a season of much glory, but of much rest. Things that have come against you, the enemy has tried to destroy in many areas. But this is over, says the Spirit of God. For for I am done with that as you are done with that. And the glory that has touched you and touched you and touched you is going to increase. You're going to enter into new realms of glory, new realms of peace, new realms of freedom. For I'm going to use your hands and I'm going to use your voice in a greater dimension in this coming year. So know that God has been watching you and that God is redeeming the time for you. And things are going to move at a different pace now. So rejoice and be glad and know that God has heard and he's answering this night in the name of Jesus and a fresh anointing. Father, I thank you for fresh glory. Fresh glory. Worship him, beloved. Worship him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We give you praise. You are the living God. The Spirit of the Lord say unto you that you're saying unto him, could I just have one word, Lord? Just one word. If I could have that one word, maybe I could go on another day. For your God says, lift those hands, for he's putting strength in you. In that mortal body of yours, the one that has been through such terror, such pain. For God is restoring you this night. God is bringing to your heart a new fight. So don't run this way and don't run that way, for the Spirit of God is running after you and lifting you up to know that your God has not left you, but your God is running with you. And this race, you will win it and you will be victorious, and your life will be good and peace will come and days will be filled with joy once again. So rejoice and know that your God loves you. Honor you. Such a God of love he is. Such a God of love. Oh, and some men can be stubborn, can't they? But God can remove the stubborn heart. God can remove the one that says, no, I won't. He can change that heart. So pray and know that your God has heard. Hallelujah. God, if you would give me an open door, I would walk through it. I see some doors opening that have been shut. Some new doors opening. Get ready. Open it up and walk through it. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we love you so much. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Master. Just lift your hands one more time. I see the Spirit of God moving again. He's moving again through this sanctuary. Touch their hands, Master. Touch them. Touch the hungry. Touch the hungry. Fill the hungry with your glory. Fill the hungry. Holy Spirit. This area right here, I see the cloud of glory over you. Let the cloud of glory come down upon your head. There. There he is. More. More. Even touching you, Frank. And Pastor Hep, lift your hands. There's a cloud of glory on you tonight. There's a cloud of glory. Rich and Kenny. There's more. There's more. And it's sweeping over this section right here. There's a cloud of glory right here. Yes. Healing of the soul. Right there. More. 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 Yes. Just let it come. He's moving right up here. The presence of Jehovah is moving up here now. up the violin. There's a sound from it tonight. The viola, whatever. Thank you, Jesus. Right here. God say, oh, your hands are hot, all right. But the manifestations will come forth more now. Because you have prayed. More manifestation. Revelation, more glory. Holy Spirit. Yes, there's the more that you've asked for. See, there's two stages of more, but there's four to come. You've had the two, but there's four more to come. There's deeper glory, and there's deeper glory, and there's deeper glory. There's more glory, deeper glory, deeper glory, deeper glory, deeper glory, deeper glory. Becky, raise your hands. I see the Holy Spirit coming down upon you. There he is. There he is. There he is. Now lay your hands on Cindy's back. There's healing.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, we exalt.
baby's name? Emma. What's her middle name? Sue. The Lord told me Sue, but I didn't get Emma. Sue is going to be a warrior. She is going to stand firm. She's going to stand tall. And she's going to be beautiful. She's going to be a beauty upon this earth. And nothing will defeat her. She will know how to battle in the spirit. And so she is a blessing unto both of you. And you will say, oh, how good it is. Let's do this again and again and again and again. Because she is a mighty, mighty baby. And she has brought blessings upon our life. And we know that she is from God. And God's going to use her. Because the power of God is going to radiate from the very fiber of her feet. And she is blessed from the very womb of her mother. She is a blessed child. Sue, the blessed child of the Most High God. The living God, we bless you. Holy Spirit, we love you so much. You are the Spirit of grace. You are the Spirit that comes and shows us things and reveals Jesus to us. Precious Holy Spirit, what would we do without you? We love you so much. Spirit of grace, Spirit of comfort, the very Spirit of life. You are. Holy Spirit, I ask that you wrap your arms around each and every one. Oh, Spirit, 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 come. Holy Spirit, come. How we love you. We're so blessed. We're so blessed that we can know you, that we can experience your love and your power and your glory. There's nothing better in the world than the presence of the Holy Spirit. When he comes, every barren area of your life becomes fruitful again. The Spirit, when he comes, he fills us. He fills us. You're at the altar. You don't have to leave. Spirit's just ministering to you. There's much more. Much more. Lift your hands. Lift. Yes. Lift your hands. There. Yes. He's pleased. He's pleased. Yes. And there's this Holy Spirit touching you. You feel him, don't you, from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet. Tears of glory are coming. Yeah. There he is. Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you. Yes, he's pleased. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you. you. What a wonderful Jesus. What a wonderful Jesus. Rose, lift your hands. Right, lift your hands, Rose. There. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Touch her hands. There he is. Yes. Just do a little more, Holy Spirit. There. Thank you, Master. Thank you. Just loving on you, Rose. There's more. Thank you. Thank you. What a good God he is. Oh, what a good God he is. You know, the world would give thousands of dollars for this peace. And we're so blessed. We're so very blessed that when he comes, hallelujah. Just put your hands on her shoulders. Yeah. Yeah. On both. Yeah, there. There's the more. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. There's the more. Oh, yes. God, you're so good. He loves each and every one of us individually and as a group. He just loves us. And he loves to pour his Spirit upon us. He loves to just love on us. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lamb. How beautiful you guys are. How beautiful you are. Did you get that? Did you? Of you that didn't make it this morning, wow, it was so beautiful, just the awesome presence of God, and tonight, just loving on us. Thank you, Jesus. You know, in this atmosphere, I have found out when there's a precious presence of the Holy Spirit, it's the best time to plant a seed, because the seed grows when there's a presence of the Lord like this. And if you'll plant that seed tonight, I just believe God will take it and bless it and multiply it. You know, the Bible says that the Father looks down from heaven on the sons of men to see if any are doing right. God looks down on our giving. He looks down on our tithing and our offering giving. And what is a tithe? A tithe is 10%. And what is an offering? An offering is what you decide in your own heart to give. And you can give your offering any place, but your tithe goes to your church. And your offering is good to, you know, put in the Hero Foundation or wherever God leads you. But it's good to be a tither and an offering giver. And God says, how have you missed me in the book of Malachi? And it says, in tithes and offerings. So we got to get on that with offerings, don't we, and tithe. So tonight, as you plant that seed, I'm going to believe with you that God's resurrection power will get a hold of that seed, and needs will be met, victory will come, harvest will come, and you'll just say, oh God, where did all this come from? Father, I just planted a little seed, and you multiplied it, Lord. Thank you. Father, I speak over your beloved seed tonight. And Father, I ask that as you look down upon their giving, that you would bless it, that you would multiply it, that you would bring so many things into their life. Because everything starts with a seed. Bless the seed sown. Multiplication In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I thank you, Lord, for honoring your beloved seed. You honor the seed giver. You honor. And when you give seed, God rebukes the seed eater for the tither and the offering giver. So he's just going to go after that seed devourer, and he's going to grab a hold of him and shake him from you, and you can have victory. Glory, glory, glory. You know, I've had this thought continue. I've had it for a few days. Why not now? And that just has been going over in my mind. I was in prayer, and I just got, why not now, God? Why not now? And I've just been speaking that out. Why not now? Why not now? Why not now? Dear ushers, go ahead. Why not now, victory? Why not now, prosperity? Why not now, blessing? Why not now, glory? Why not now, healing? Why not now to see the manifestations that we've been believing God for? Why not now? Can you sing that?
This hour, we're all together, together, waiting here as one. There is power, power, it's here in this hour, this hour.
That was good. Hallelujah. Wow. That was good. You still didn't sing Why Not Now. Now, come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, guys. God bless you. Hallelujah. Why not now, God? Why not now? Hallelujah. Oh, God. I'll be quick tonight. I'm a short preacher, about 5'3" and a half, so we'll get this going. Book of James. Hallelujah. You know, like this morning, and you can go to church, and you can experience the power of God and the glory of God, and everything is so wonderful, and then you get in your car, and maybe not that soon, but then you get home, and all of a sudden, you're you again. And everything that happened at church, all the glory that happened, all the deliverance, all the freedom was there, and then you turn into you again. And you don't want to be you again, you want to be him. And you want to keep him, and you want to keep him in your heart. You want to keep the fire burning. You don't want the passion to dry up. Father, we thank you for your word this night. We thank you for this reason. We bow our knees to the Lord Jesus Christ, whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that you might grant us, according to your riches and glory, to be strengthened with might through your spirit by the inner man, that Christ may dwell in our heart by faith, that we be rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints. We got to have that comprehension. The very depth of the love of Christ. How much he loves us and what he wants to do in us and the victory he wants us to live in daily. Matter of fact, for some of it, it's just not a daily victory. It's a moment by moment victory. We can't wait on the daily. We need it right now. Maybe second by second, a twinkling of an eye. We got to have the victory. Well, the reason that a lot of us don't live in that victory, it's because of our soul. The soul is composed of the will, mind, and the emotions. And the spirit, when you are born again, your spirit man is born again to the max. It starts hungering for the things of God. Your spirit man, every service wants revival. Every day wants to be in prayer, wants everything from the Word of God, the Spirit of God. But your soul... Now, that's our problem. The soul, the Bible says, well, let's read this in James chapter 1, verse 21. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Now, that word there, superfluity, means it's not necessary. So naughtiness is not necessary, so lay it aside. Don't get naughty, you know. And receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. So there is a saving of the souls. And the saving of the souls is by renewing of the mind by the word of God. And if our mind has been renewed by the word of God, our soul will get to the place where our soul is just as hungry. When something comes against our mind, our will, our emotions to try to destroy this inside, one of these inside beings of ours, our spirit, our soul, and our body, when something comes against that, our soul will get to the place where it will yield to the spirit. And as the soul yields to the spirit, that is the saving of the soul. The Bible says, you know, our weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of Christ, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And that's our job. We have to bring into captivity our thoughts. We have to. So when you've been in the presence of God, in the presence of revival, and you leave and all of a sudden the soul starts acting up, you start speaking to that through the word of God. And that's what you have to do. For there is a daily saving of the soul. God wants your soul to be so on fire. And when the soul has been so redeemed and so transformed by the very word of God, that metamorphosis comes our way because of the word of God has gone into our heart so strong with such power, with such glory and such anointing that the soul can't help but be saved. And when the soul is so saved and so transformed by the very word of God, then the flesh that likes to eat cupcakes and likes to eat all these things. You know, I just did a terrible thing. For a month, I fasted sweets and breads, didn't eat anything. Sweets and breads. And I just wanted a Cruda's cupcake so bad. And I didn't lose a pound. And then I quit fasting, you know, and I ate sweets for a couple of days and gained 5 pounds. So it's not fair. So the flesh has to be, the flesh has to get under control. And when the soul is where it should be, that flesh man will conform. And then that triune being of yours will get to the place when you leave the house of God and you've been touched by the fire of God. You've been touched by revival. You can keep it. Somebody can come to you and be so mean and nasty and say something to you so bad. And you know what will happen? It'll just go, won't even bother you. You know, you let the birds fly over your head, but you don't have to let them nest in there. And if you have a bird nesting in there, it's going to be a very dirty thing. And so you don't want them nesting. So when those thoughts come, you cast down those imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the very word of Christ. Because this word is where our hope is in this word, because this word is Jesus. How can we separate Jesus from the word of God? Because the Bible says in Book of John, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. All things were made through him, and there was nothing made that was made without him. And in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And then it goes on to say the word became. It became everything you want it to become. That's what it becomes. If you want the word to become power in your life, it will become power. If you want the word to become victory, it'll become victory. Whatever you want the word to become, and you take a hold of it, that's what that word will become for you. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. I like it. I like this. It says, come unto me. So he's saying, come unto me. Come on. Jesus is saying, come unto me. You know, you read the Gospels and you see where they came. They came. They were all coming to Jesus. Blind Bartimaeus came to Jesus and had to throw down his robe, didn't he? The lady with the issue of blood came to Jesus and she didn't no more have an issue anymore. Her issue was gone. You see the centurion when he came to Jesus on behalf of his servant. You see even the Syrophoenician lady. Everyone that came to Jesus got a miracle, got a reward for coming to Jesus. And he says, come on. And it's up to us. It's up to us to get our soul in line with the word of God that we will be able to come to him. Come to me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke, that's the very cross, upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly of heart. And ye shall find rest for your souls. You'll find rest for your souls. It says, come unto me first. And then it says, all you that labor and are heavy laden. You know, the enemy can put such a burden on our soulish man. So many things can come against us. Pastor Happ will come home and he'll say, honey, I feel like I just can't get it done. Everybody in the country's mad at me because I can't get the orders done. I'm trying and trying. I just can't get it done. And I'm just home getting the reward from his labor. And I feel bad sometimes. I get the reward. But that's how it is. Jesus labored for us, and we get the reward for his labor. Isn't that good? We get the reward. He said, I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. He says, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. If we would, it's just getting that soul to thirst as much as the spirit thirsts. If I could get my soul thirsty for the things of God, my soul, instead of thirsting for television or thirsting for I don't know what else your soul might thirst for. But if it thirsts for other things besides God, we got to start putting it under like we put the flesh under. For the soul goes after other things. You know, in Matthew 5:6, it said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. There's a hungering and a thirsting for God. If you're really thirsty, you read the Gospels and you see where they were so thirsty for Jesus that Jesus would get on a mountain and they would stay there for days without food, without anything. And Jesus said, what are we going to do for all of these here? They've been with me. And us in the new modern age church, here we are. If our service goes past an hour and a half or 2 hours, oh my God. I got to get to the restaurant. You know, I got to get someplace. I got to do something else. And if we'd ever get to the place where we just take his yoke upon us, if we would learn of him, if we would take a hold of him and let him be so big in our heart that our soul would have to melt in the very presence of God. There's a saving of the soul. A saving of the soul. That's why a lot of you born-again Christians are not filled with satisfaction. You're not where you should be in the Lord, because your souls are running other ways from the word of God, from Christ. You have to put the soul under the mind, will, and emotions. Has to get in line with the very spirit of God within us. See, God dwells in you. The spirit of God dwells in you. And how do you get to him? You turn within. Because that's where he is. He's in here. And you turn within into the very spirit of the living God. And you make your soul and you make your flesh behave and get a hold of the very spirit of God. Paul, you know, in his epistle, Paul said in Philippians 3:10, "Oh, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed unto his death." Take up your cross and follow me. What good does it do to gain the whole world and to lose your soul? If I would follow after him with everything within me, if I would be so hungry that I can't wait to get that very place in him, I'm so excited when I get to church, I want to be the one that brings revival into the house of God. I want to be the one that shouts and praises God. I want them to see the very spirit of God in me. God, come, come. In Isaiah 55, verse 1, it says, "Everyone that thirsts, come ye to the waters." He's saying, come. What are the waters? The very waters of the presence of God. The very waters of the Spirit of God that will come and sweep over you. Come to the waters. "He that hath no money." It's so neat, the presence of God. You don't have to pay a dime for that. You don't need any money for the presence of God. All you need is a soul that's very thirsty, that will join in with your spirit. "Come ye, come and eat." Yay, come. Didn't Jesus say, "Eat of me"? Remember when he told the disciples, there was more than 70 of them. He told them, "You have to eat of me and drink of me." And it says many at that time turned away from him because of that saying. It was too hard to take. They couldn't understand that he was telling them that you need to be so one with me, so wrapped up in me, that my blood covers you, that my very flesh is your flesh, that my heart is your heart, that we are melted into one, we are meshed together, we're entwined by the very spirit of the living God. We're entwined with each other. And they couldn't understand that, and they turned away from it. Psalm 63 says, verse 1, "My soul thirsts for the living God." I'm thirsting for the living God. My soul. It doesn't say my spirit. My soul is thirsting for the living God. "I thirst for him in a dry and weary land where there is no water, that I may see his glory and power as I have seen it in his sanctuary. Because his loving kindness is better than life. My lips will bless him, and I will lift my hands in his name. And my soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness when I come to him." When I come. And you know, it's always, something's always happening. Something's always trying to get us away from the presence of God. Always. You know, I came home last night. Yesterday was so awesome last night. And, well, dear Ellen's homegoing. What a mighty woman of God she is. And she's very much alive. And she's celebrating with us. I'm sure all day long she has celebrated with us. And she's telling us, come on, take care of Norm. Come on, take care of Norm. Watch over him. And last night with the Hero Foundation, all the people that came, I just couldn't believe they're coming and coming and coming. And even the lady from Channel 11, I was talking with her, and she says, "Do all these people go to your church?" And I said, "No, they don't." She's, "Oh, my goodness." And she says, "There's all kinds of people here, all ages and all kinds, the young and the old, and it's so wonderful." And so I left all excited, and I got home. Do you ever get home? And I'm very picky with my home. And my son Tony had babysat. He watched Judah and Benjamin, Pastor Greg's two little ones, and my great-grandbaby Aria, who's two, and my son Tony, who's 26, maybe 27, 28 now. Oh, wow. He's getting really old. And he babysat. And so I was so tired. It was about 12 o'clock, and I was very glad to just go in the house and just go to bed, get all the grandkids to bed. And I walked in the house, and he said, Mom, we had a problem. The toilet overflowed, and I had to use every towel in the house. And you have no towels left, and it's just a big mess in there. I said, all right, I can take care of that. I didn't have a plunger, so I had to run to Pastor Greg's house as quick as I could, and I stole your plunger. And so we start, Pastor Hap's cleaning that mess up, and so then I go into the den. And my soul, we have a glass top table that's on, the glass is on top of the wood. And he had let the kids take Frosted Flakes and pour them all over the table, all in the cracks of glass, and soda poured over that, and oats over that. And the Frosted Flakes are all over the whole den. And they're all in the couch. And they're every place. And then in the kitchen, there's oats and food stuck all over the floor. And I'm like, my soul. Have you ever been there and done that? So I had to clean all night. And then after prayer this morning, I had to scrub all the floors. And I'm like, my soul. Ashley knows. I'm a fanatic, yeah. But you have to get the soul in line with the Word of God. But my soul never once complained. I just said, thank you, baby, for watching them. I appreciate it. Yeah. Hallelujah. You're thirsty. Why not now, God? Why not now when I leave the sanctuary? When I leave this house? Why not be the time that I put my soul under? That I make my soul conform to the very Word of God? That you may be conformed to me, he says. Conformed. Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, for labor for that which satisfies not? Hearken diligently unto me, and you eat that what is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Where does the fatness come? It comes from the Word of God. I can tell you tonight, beloved, if you get the Word of God in you, you got to get him in. And that Word is alive. It's powerful. It's able to change anything. The Word of God makes you more than a conqueror. The Word of God makes you that person in Christ that you need to be, whether you're going through hell or whatever you're going through. You can go through it, and you keep going through it. And you might have to fight the soul, and you might have to fight the flesh, but you keep going through it until the victory comes. And one day you wake up in the morning, and because you put your soul under and you've had your soul saved by the very Word of God, you wake up and all of a sudden you're that new creature in Christ that he has made you to be, and you're able to live that day in victory. And when the enemy comes at you and reminds you of what you're going through, you'd say, I'm not going there. I'm not going there. I won't live in that. No, no. Why not now, Lord? Why not now that I be so filled with you? Incline your ear and come unto me here, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. And the sure mercies of David means that God became man, the incarnation. God became man for us, not only to save you in your spirit man and deliver you. He wants your triune being, your spirit, soul, and your body to stand strong before God, that you can say no to temptation, you can say no to liquor, you can say no to the things that will destroy your flesh, you can say no to the things that will destroy your mind. Every word that the enemy has brought against you, every mean word that somebody has said against you, you can put it under. I remember the time when I went to a service and my best friend had hurt me so bad. I had told Hap, nobody has hurt me this bad in my whole life. And the prophet of God called me out and said, nobody has hurt you that bad in your whole life. the same words that I had said. And that quick I was delivered. That quick. Because I knew that my God knew and my God cares and he's watching over me to perform his word, and all he's wanting me to do is get a hold of this word and believe it and act upon it. Hallelujah. In Isaiah 44, verse 3 says, I will pour water upon him that is thirsty and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon this upon thy seed and thy blessings upon thy offspring. And that was fulfilled right there. This verse was fulfilled on the day of Pentecost. The lady at the well, John 4, remember her? She was getting some of world water. She was at the well getting some world water. And Jesus was there and says, I can give you some water that you'll never thirst again for world water. He says, I'll give it to you if you want it. She says, oh, where? How can I get this water? How can I get it? And when the disciples came back, I just love that they says, you know, asked Jesus about food. He says, I have food that you don't even know about. Where did he go? Did he go to a restaurant? What did he do? How did he get it? His food was to do the will of God. Thirsting after God. She was changed from that day on. Just a couple more scriptures and we'll close. Revelations 22:17 says, the Spirit and the bride say, come. He that hears, come. He that thirsts, come. If you're thirsty, come. He says, whosoever will, come and take of the water of life freely. It's free. Come. Come. In Isaiah 35, it's one of my favorite scriptures. It's talking about the millennial reign, what's going to transpire when the Lord God, when the new Jerusalem comes down out of heaven as a bride adorned for her king, and it's going to land right there in Jerusalem. It's going to come down, that holy city. And this is talking about the millennial reign, what is going to happen. But I believe with all my heart, as we enter in closer to the days, these days that we are in now, our church is going to experience greater and greater revival. You don't go through something like we've been through with God not sending a great blessing. When the enemy comes in to steal, kill, and destroy, God will raise up that standard and a great blessing will come. And I believe the blessings is all of you hungering and thirsting after righteousness, hungering after God, getting your souls in line with the very word of God, that you can stand tall in the presence of God and you can receive what God has for you, because he has much for you, much. It says here in verse 3, it says, strengthen ye the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not, for your God will come with vengeance. And he will come with the recompense of God, and he will come and save you. When he comes, why not now? Why not right now, my soul get in line with the word of God? My spirit be strong. Why not now can I enter into that realm of the spirit where I hunger and thirst for? Why not now? Why not now? Why not run? Run to him. Go there. Go after God with everything within you. And then when that happens, then the eyes of the blind will be opened, the ears of the deaf will be unstopped. The lame man shall leap like a deer. The tongue of the dumb shall sing. In the wilderness, waters shall break out and springs in the desert. The parched ground shall become a pool. And the thirsty land springs of water. In the habitation where dragons laid, this is where the devil is, where the devil has been tormenting you, where the devil has been stealing, killing, and destroying, where he's laid and he's made a nest, says what God's going to do. There will be grass with reeds and rushes. That means the Spirit of God will come. Everything will be green. Everything will be beautiful. Well, one more scripture. Can we do one more? One more. Just one more. Oh, they're all so good. It's just like you want to. This one's really good. Psalm 42. And I know Pastor Greg likes that one too. King David wrote this one. And they say it was probably when his son Absalom was trying to kill him. Never had your son trying to kill you. That would be a very bad place to be, wouldn't it? Very pet. It says, as the deer panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. Here he's going through a terrible time with his son. You know, in his family, there's been murder, there's been distress, there's been horrors. Absalom trying to take his kingdom, now trying to kill him. But you know the story, Absalom ends up dying, his hair gets caught in a tree branch, and he's hung. And then when he finds out his son has died, he says, oh, my son, my son. He says, my soul thirsts after thee, O God. See, we got to get to that place where our soul is thirsting after God so strong that we put it under. And the saving of the soul has been made us get to the place where we can stand strong in the presence of God. He says, my soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. He says, when shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my meat day and night while they continually stand to me, where is your God? The devil said that to you before. Where's God? Where was your God at that time? Where'd he go? Where's God? Where is he? He's always there. He's always here. He's just waiting for you to come. He says, when I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me, crying out a soul unto God. Oh, God, I remember when I used to go on holy day. I used to go with all of them to the temple, and I would rejoice. But now, oh, God, look where I am, and I'm pouring my soul out to you. But David said, I will have to remember. I will have to call back the good things of God, and I will remember what you did for me. And I know that you love me. He says here, oh God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore, verse 6, therefore will I remember thee. You got to get to the place when you're going through something. I remember God. I remember God. Oh soul within me, you will not be like this. You will remember your God. Hallelujah. For God is a good God. He's so faithful. The deep calleth unto the deep. At that noise of thy waterspouts, all thy waves and billows have gone over me. My very spirit within me is crying to the very spirit of the living God. And when I get to that place in him, his presence, his glory will wash over me. And then my mind is renewed and I can go on another moment in Christ. Hallelujah. And then he ends in verse 11. Why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted within me? And then he says the most wonderful word here. Hope, great, intense, happy desire of good. When we were waiting on our hope that we adopted from Korea, every day I would pray, our great, intense, happy desire of good. And she blesses me. Oh, she blesses me. Yeah. Hope. Deferred maketh the heart sick. And then he says, for I shall yet praise him who is the help of my countenance and my God. Whoa. He is the help. And what did David do? He said, I shall yet still praise him. Let's stand up. Hallelujah. He is the help of my countenance, my God. So what are we going to do when the enemy comes after our soulish man? What do we do? Say, be quiet. Help of my God. Let's lift our hands and say, Father, I thank you for the saving of the soul. I thank you that your word is true and it always works. So I will work your word with everything within me. And I thank you that you are a very living God. You're always present. And you love me. And I love you. Hallelujah. Thank you. Pastor Greg. Thank you.
Well, nothing too small. We're just going to go change the world this week. Are you ready? Are you ready? Now, there's a lot of testimonies coming in, and this is not something we're stopping because this is a lifestyle. And we are so blessed with what God's doing. And Father, we just thank you, Lord. We just thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives. And we say, why not us? Why not now? In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. We love you guys so much. If you have any special prayer requests, the altars will be open. There's actually some desserts that are across the foyer and the youth room for those that would like some desserts. And I think they were what was left over from the bake sale. So it's fresh, good stuff. Okay. And so we just, again, the altars will be open, but have an incredible week. Share the love of the gospel of Jesus with Christ with at least 10 or 20 people, and we'll see you again on Wednesday.
Search for all eternity. There's no